Welcome to A State of Mind. This is Julian Royce. Okay, today's episode has been about 8 months in the making. In some ways, it's really been several years in the making. The challenging topics which we talk about directly in my conversation with Ho today are part of the inspiration for creating a State of the Mind podcast 3 years ago. It directly rose out of having gone to Naropa University and having graduated with a degree in mindfulness-based transpersonal psychology, and having been in this educational environment where it felt as though I wasn't allowed, and in fact, actively discouraged from authentically expressing and exploring these challenging topics around things like social justice, critical race theory, and all the rest of it, what my guest today, Ho, calls wokeism. And so Ho is going by his Buddhist name. He was is a former Zen monk, and he's going by that name in order to stay anonymous. In my time at Naropa University, it took me a little while to realize that the entire university seemed to have become infected with this quote-unquote wokeism, and the subjects relating to it were brought up dutifully in every class, and I could see where in every single class the syllabus had some copy and pasted thing around social justice issues inserted. So it's clearly a big priority of the university. And as I discussed with Ho, these are really important topics that deserve to be talked about and addressed. They, of course, relate to psychology and mindfulness, and in some sense, they can be related to everything, but that doesn't mean that they need to be brought into every single conversation. And so hopefully if you listen to this conversation, you'll get more a sense of what I am talking about if you're not already aware of this phenomena. So I was really considering not publishing this episode, even after recording it. I was questioning if it was worth it. These are controversial topics. Do I need to stir up controversy? I even talked about it with a friend of mine who's a Buddhist lama or teacher, and he said, maybe it's better not to. You know, maybe it's better to just put positive things out there. But then I went to go see a lecture on psychedelic-assisted therapy, and this other person at the lecture recognized me, came up and said hello, and I said, do you remember me? I was in the worst class ever taught. And I knew instantly what they were talking about. They were a former classmate from Naropa University and had been in my class, the first class of the semester called Multicultural Social Foundations, something like that. It was so poorly taught. I was talking to this woman and all these issues came up, and I mentioned this podcast idea and she's like, yes, you should do it. And then multiple other people in my life gave me that feedback. They said, this needs to be talked about, and you should be the one to do it. And so here I am. And so really my intention here is not to criticize or to tear down Naropa University, but to encourage it as much as I can to move in a different direction. And I'm not discouraging anyone from attending there, but if you do attend there, you should know what you're getting into. And it could be an opportunity for you to advocate for making the university more open-minded, to get back in touch with more of its original values, and to be a place that can honor more nuanced, authentic conversations about these difficult issues rather than forcing a kind of ideological purity on people. So what is meant by quote-unquote wokeism? I'm not going to get into all the nuances here. That's what the two-hour conversation with Ho does to some degree. And there's a lot of great resources and links listed in the show notes to this episode, so you can learn more about it if you want. But I can say it's a kind of radical far-left ideology marked by a fairly extreme intolerance for any dissenting opinions or nuanced conversation. One of the main tenets of this wokeism seems to be the idea that not only is America a racist society, but it's in fact a white supremacist society. And this is a really astounding claim. It's a really radical claim. You know, if you ask the average people across our great country if they think of our country in this way, most of them will say no, with the exception of those who have been infected by this wokeism. Maybe, you know, it's become really dominant in a lot of educational institutions. And unfortunately, what becomes dominant in higher education tends to percolate throughout the greater society. So many of us are being really encouraged to think of our country in these extremely negative terms. And of course, if you look at the history of our country, it's really characterized by a movement towards greater human rights, greater freedoms enshrined in law. We have the civil rights, we have the Civil War, etc., etc. Another characteristic of wokeism is to attack anyone who disagrees with it by calling them racist or some other similar term. This is exactly like the old witch trials. You know, someone used to be accused of being a witch, some poor unfortunate soul. There would be a trial, which was of course a kind of sham. And one way they would do this is they would throw them into a body of water. If the person floated on the water, it proved somehow that they were a witch and they would be burned at the stake. If, on the other hand, they sank in the water, It would prove that they were on God's side and in fact not a witch. Of course, either way, the person died. And statistics, in fact, show that an increasing number of students in universities across the United States of America are afraid of speaking up. This is a real problem, not just for higher education, but for our whole country. Without real dialogue, real debate, being able to express yourself authentically and try out different ideas, a tremendous opportunity to come to new, different, and deeper understandings of complex issues is lost. In my conversation with Ho, I referenced the book The Coddling of the American Mind by Jonathan Haidt. I'm a big fan of this book, and a lot of the things he talks about in it are directly relevant to our conversation. And so in this book, he outlines three great untruths, he calls them, quote unquote, that wokeism is guilty of. And unfortunately, these are becoming all too common at Naropa University. And so we discuss this more in depth in our conversation, but I'll just briefly name them here in the introduction. The first great untruth talked about in The Coddling of the American Mind is the untruth of fragility. What doesn't kill you makes you weaker. This leads to problems like safetyism, trying to constantly protect everyone's feelings, and attacks on freedom of speech and the linking of free speech to being racist and oppressive. The second great untruth is the untruth of emotional reasoning. Always trust your feelings. Jonathan Haidt does a great job of discussing why this is terrible advice. And the third great untruth is the untruth of us versus them, that life is a battle between good people and evil people. And again, this is a terrible thing to believe. It is, in a lot of ways, the opposite of the Buddhist teachings. And as I discussed in the conversation with Ho, it's so ironic that Naropa University, this Buddhist school founded by a Buddhist teacher with amazing Buddhist lineages behind it, has come to this place. To give greater context to our conversation, I'm going to give some background here and read from this incredible document I have called the Title IX Investigative Report. So a little bit of background. Ho applied to and was accepted to the Contemplative Psychotherapy and Buddhist Psychology program at Naropa University. And then last summer, before he began his first semester, he emailed some people in the administration. He asked if he would have to believe or follow a particular ideology. He named that he didn't subscribe to critical race theory, for example. And he was reassured by email that he didn't have to subscribe to that or believe a certain ideology to be a student here. And then when he began school, he quickly felt ostracized and alienated for not subscribing to what he calls wokeism. And it got so bad that he filed a complaint with the Title IX office, who then did an investigation, interviewed different people, and produced this remarkable report. So I'm just going to read from this report. I'm not going to read every word of it, but I am going to read a good part of it, probably the majority of it, so you can hear it for yourself and come to your own decisions. It's a really remarkable document. I can't say that everything in it is 100% true or anything like that, but I think it would be foolish to just totally dismiss it. So here we go. Executive summary. The complainant, a first-year graduate student in the Contemplative Psychotherapy and Buddhist Psychology program within the Graduate School of Counseling and Psychology at Naropa University, submitted a formal complaint of retaliation for a pattern of retaliatory conduct directed against him as a result of concerns he raised about discriminatory conduct by Naropa staff and in violation of Title IX and Naropa's Equal Opportunity Anti-Harassment and Non-Discriminatory Policy and Procedure. While the complainant submitted a complaint specifically alleging retaliation, his complaint raises significant concerns of pervasive hostile environment, sex-based discrimination, which underlies and is inextricably coupled with the retaliation claims. A formal inquiry was commenced. After a thorough review of the evidence, the coordinator investigator finds that Naropa University retaliated against the complainant and that the university, specifically the CPBP program, exhibited a pattern and practice of discriminatory attitudes and actions resulting in a hostile and discriminatory climate targeting men, and in particular white men. At issue in this case are whether the concerns, opinions of discrimination expressed by the complainant constitute a failure to meet course program and professional standards for counselors, or whether these expressions are protected activity. Summary of relevant facts and application of policy. On September 24th, 2021, the complainant contacted the Dean of Students via email to report alleged retaliation for voicing concerns about sex-based discrimination he faced arising out of class discussions interactions. A series of alleged retaliatory conduct ensued, which resulted in an allegedly hostile environment. Prior to enrolling at Naropa, the complainant contacted the university as part of his due diligence in deciding whether or not to attend. One primary concern expressed by the complainant related to the university's commitment to academic freedom and freedom of expression. Specifically, the complainant noted that part of his belief system as an anti-racist included a vehement disagreement with critical race theory and critical social justice as a means of combating racism, which he found to be counterproductive to combating racism. In July 21, 2021, there was an email outlining the general objectives and standards of competence required to successfully complete the program, and the complainant was told, "You are not required to subscribe to any particular ideology to succeed. You do need to meet basic competencies as laid out by the counseling profession." They also stated there is no de facto ideology in the school or department. As a result of these assurances, the complainant proceeded with enrolling in the program, which he began in fall of 2021. In one of his courses titled Professional Orientation, he was assigned readers and class discussions, frequently contained derogatory statements directed against men in the context of men as oppressors generally. In one such class discussion, derogatory references to old white men were made. After class, the complainant emailed the instructor privately to express his concern and discomfort at the use of these derogatory statements and sentiments within the class discussion. A string of email communications ensued. The complainant expressed continued distress that his concerns around discriminatory conduct were being dismissed and misinterpreted, to which the instructor requested a mandatory meeting with the complainant to include the program chair. The complainant objected to the meeting, which he perceived as retaliatory abuse of power in response to his exercise of rights under Title IX. However, he did attend the meeting. Notes taken by the instructor of the meeting reflect that the three remained in disagreement around issues of legality and appropriateness of the manner in which multiculturalism and diversity is taught. The complainant's position being that he was open to learning about the various perspectives, theories, and positions on these topics, but that the teaching style in which it was presented was discriminatory in violation of the law and policy. Both instructors who were present at the meeting referred the complainant to the Title IX office. The complainant then prematurely left a retreat, attendance and participation at which is a required component of the program. He left because of citing discomfort due to hostility. He then made a formal complaint about retaliation to the Title IX office. A few weeks later, five students emailed the core faculty expressing concern that the complainant non-participation at the retreat and refusal to engage in work involving, quote, racial justice was causing disruption within the cohort. Additional concerns and complaints about the complainant's opinions were raised by fellow students as well as other faculty members. Examples of offending discussion posts were provided and reviewed. The posts were provided as evidence of the complainant's failure to meet program expectations. Upon review, it is clear that they simply expressed positions and opinions which are not aligned with the most vocal, prevailing opinions on campus and endorsed by Naropa University, but do not contain any content violative of school policy or published standards of conduct. On or around end of November, the complainant shared some material presented in class on the topics of toxic masculinity. One portion of the material included a video post where the presenter stated something to the effect of "Dear men, get therapy," as one example of the culture of hostility directed towards men. Interviews with co-students, Student 1 and Student 2. Both Student 1 and Student 2 are fellow students in the same cohort as the complainant. Student 1 stated she finds the atmosphere within the CPBP program to be extremely intolerant of positions which are not fully aligned with prevailing ideologies of critical race and related theories. She stated these theories are being taught as fact and that everything is viewed through the lens of race and social location, with white and dominant, i.e. male students, labeled as oppressors and are not allowed to speak in class. She voiced concerns about these perceptions in a private meeting with Instructor 1. She noted that the complainant is ostracized in class and by fellow students. She observed he rarely participates in class discussions, is quiet, reserved, and she had never heard or witnessed him say anything offensive, disrespectful, or racist. The class had a group chat that the complainant had been excluded from. She noted that the complainant is a former Buddhist monk with a calm demeanor and, her opinion, believes hostility faced by him as a result of extreme intolerance and his identity as a member of the dominant group, i.e. white, cisgendered, and male. Student 2 observed that the climate was generally antagonistic towards males and towards the complainant specifically. When asked if she'd ever witnessed the complainant behaving in a disrespectful manner, she stated that she had not. On the contrary, the complainant presents as humble, calm, and very polite. During class, a Naropa instructor made a public comment in front of the entire cohort stating that anyone with political views like the complainant's would not be allowed to graduate. Wow! I mean, come on. The dean of graduate psychology and one of the professors contacted the Title IX coordinator to discuss moving forward with a notice of concern for the complainant based on the above noted disagreements. The coordinator requested an explanation for the notice of concern, stating that it should be based on objective published criteria. and advising that if a notice of concern was given to the complainant and not supported by such criteria, moving forward could raise concerns of retaliation, giving the pending complaint an investigation. So two of the professors decided to move forward with a notice of concern, a draft of which was given to the Title IX coordinator end of November 2021. The notice of concern focuses on discussion posts made by the complainant in courses taught by these Naropa professors, and it serves to the student, i.e. the person I'm interviewing in this podcast, as a final warning prior to being expelled from the university. Come on, really? I mean, it's just, wow. Discussion and findings. Using a preponderance of the evidence standard, based on the evidence collected, it is more likely than not that Naropa both discriminated and retaliated against the complainant, and that the university climate and culture generally violates Title IX and university policy, prohibiting protected class discrimination as a pattern and practice, resulting in a hostile learning environment against men, and especially those with additional intersecting quote-unquote privileged characteristics listed here as white, heterosexual, and Christian. While Naropa's mission and values focused on issues of equity and diversity are laudable, the manner in which they have been advanced in this case clearly run afoul of Naropa's published policy and federal non-discrimination laws, including Title IX. Title IX law says, no person shall be, on the basis of sex, excluded from participation in, be denied the benefits of, or be subjected to discrimination under any educational program or activity receiving federal financial assistance. The complainant voiced opinions which do not conform to ideologies advanced and embraced by Naropa, which do in fact perpetuate biased attitudes about men. Whether this bias is justified to advance social and racial equity is open to debate. Naropa has taken the position it is not only justifiable but represents a moral and ethical imperative. The culture at Naropa, specifically within the CPBP program, reflects this. While President Leaf assured the complainant that students have a right to hold a view about critical race theory that differs from Naropa's institutional views, and one of the professors, here called Instructor 2, stated that the university does not ascribe to any specific ideology, the evidence suggests otherwise. In interviewing Instructor 1, she was explicit in stating that not only does the university endorse this ideology, she also stated that she as a faculty member is evaluated on her adherence to this ideology. Wow, that's incredible, right? That's why this episode is titled The Woke Takeover of Naropa University and why I'm publishing it to speak out against this in the hopes that the university can choose a new direction. This professor further stated that not only is this university policy, but that it externally mandated by oversight bodies responsible for the oversight of the counseling program and professional practice requirements in the field of counseling psychology, directly referencing the ACA Code of Ethics, which she claims establishes standards students must meet in order to graduate Naropa's counseling program. So here's a point of debate. I would disagree with that, but different people are entitled to their opinions. Back to the report. Leadership and faculty within the CPBP program fully embraces this position, frequently misapplying their ideological belief systems as per se equivalent to external professional standards and criteria necessary for practicing in the counseling profession. When the complainant complained of these biases, he faced immediate and continued escalation of intimidating and punitive response, resulting in and contributing to an already hostile environment based on his status as a male. Perhaps most indicative of the overt hostility and discriminatory culture against those perceived to be in privileged social locations, i.e. white men, which pervades the university, is Instructor One's statement that it is impossible to discriminate against white men by definition. I believe she shared and insisted as an absolute truth during the investigative interview. So that's a really interesting thing, and me and Ho talk about that in our conversation, but that's a hell of a statement. And like I said earlier in the introduction, to question that, to disagree with it, is to open yourself up to be called a racist. It's interesting that this Title IX investigator uses the phrase absolute truth. You know, in Buddhism, we talk about relative and ultimate truths, and part of the conversation with Ho here is the sadness of Naropa University's Buddhist lineage and legacy being caught up in this kind of a thing. So I'll continue with the report. This belief that it is impossible to discriminate against white males by definition, which appears to be part of the official position taken by the university, was echoed by student 3, who shared a concern via email with Instructor 2 about discussion posts that the complainant had made. In this email, student 3 stated her concern that the complainant's non-conformance to prevailing university ideology with respect to the university's position on racial justice, quote, his posts indicate a deep and righteous denial of the realities of racism and sexism in this country, and then claims of the reverse towards men, which is simply not possible by definition. Furthermore, in addition to the relevant facts surrounding the complainant's specific complaint, there are numerous other concerning facts pointing to an overarching discriminatory culture and climate at Naropa. And then this report goes into some of the past history that I guess the Title IX office has received. In 2016, the university hired an outside investigator to examine allegations of disparate and discriminatory treatment of men in the CPBP program. While the investigation did not result in formal findings, it did find that Naropa should make broad efforts to address diversity issues specific to men, including the need to take actions not to alienate men. The report found that notions of, quote, white male privilege and male privilege are frequently taught and discussed, and that this is frequently done in an accusatory manner, making men feel attacked. The report then says, in my tenure as Title IX coordinator, 100% of the formal complaints received by the Title IX office are focused on allegations of pervasive discrimination against those from the perceived dominant oppressor groups, always male, within the CPBP program. Men's opinions, when they deviate from Naropa's prevailing ideology, are routinely dismissed in class discussions, i.e. they are accused of, quote, taking up space. They are accused of not understanding how their social locations impact students from marginalized groups and how it may be harmful to such students, etc. In effect, men are routinely excluded, derided, ostracized, and dismissed, and or are accused of being racist, unaware, or harmful. In some cases, these men face punitive action, such as the notice of concern process, or excluded from successfully progressing through the program for nonconformance with the culture, which penalizes men for engaging in alternative views. And the report goes on, as noted by Professor 1 and Student 3, each of whom made the assertion that men cannot be discriminated against by definition, this sentiment appears to permeate the culture and is evidence of a complete misunderstanding of federal law, which prohibits discrimination on the basis of sex. The fact that sex includes both male and female, and discrimination against either is prohibited against the law, is not open to debate. That's a really interesting point. And then it says, throughout my tenure as Title IX coordinator, several high-level officials within the university have confided privately that the CPBP program is deeply troubled, inappropriately utilizes the notice of concern process against students whose expressed beliefs do not conform with university-endorsed ideologies surrounding privilege and power, and that the program leadership abuses its so-called gatekeeping role in a similar manner, primarily targeting white males who dare to voice different opinions or perspectives. And then it says, this part was kind of interesting, restitution. It recommends that restitution should be made to the complainant to include minimally a refund of all monies paid by the complainant to Naropa University. I doubt that happened. And it recommends Naropa to review its policies, training, program, oversight, faculty standards, and promotion systems to ensure that the ingrained culture of discrimination against men and others subjectively perceived to be, quote, oppressors due to protected class status is eradicated. In its zeal to address perceived historical wrongs, the university has embraced an approach which runs afoul of federal non-discrimination law. And so I will end there. This is a 11-page report. Gave you guys the highlights, and I wanted to spend the time to read that because, like I said, it's so interesting and it's so clear. Yeah, those aren't my words. Those are the words of the Title IX investigator. Of course, the university can disagree with it. For the record, I reached out to Naropa University for comment about this podcast episode and have thus far received no response. Emailed them about 4 weeks ago. So, without further ado, I present this conversation with Ho. I hope you enjoy it and get something out of it, and I hope it contributes to our culture growing and evolving to one of greater compassion, equality, and understanding, and diversity of opinions, and to real debate and discussion taking place. So, here you go. Please enjoy. So, I'm here today with Ho, a name you're choosing to go by in part to preserve your anonymity, if I'm saying that right. Do you want to introduce yourself a little bit?
Sure. So I'm currently going by the name Ho because as I progress in this field, I don't want to be associated on Google with any particular controversy, at least not at the moment. How far back should I go? Ho means Dharma in Japanese. It's the first part of my name that I was given when I ordained as a Zen monk. I'm no longer an ordained monk, but I did keep the name.
How long were you a monk for?
Technically, I think I am still a monk until I just lapse out of the books in Japan. But in spirit, I was a monk for, 5 years or something. I lived in Zen centers and monasteries in California, Japan, Thailand, and Burma for about 10 years, more or less. Wow. Yeah.
That's a long time.
Yeah. I wanted to begin, since I'll be saying some controversial things to some people, wanted to begin with an acknowledgement of this, because some people just need to hear this explicitly, an acknowledgement that racism is real, that sexism is real, that bigotry, homophobia, all kinds of bigotry are real. And that I am vehemently opposed to all forms of oppression.
Thank you. Yeah, I really appreciate that. And let people know, and I'll make an introduction for the episode too, but that I met you when you were still a student at Naropa University, and you reached out to me right before you left the school, which is a big part of what we're going to talk about. Mm-hmm. And part of your path getting there is your interest in Buddhism, meditation, being a monk, and then wanting to be in the field of psychology and therapist and healing, right?
Exactly. So I'm 42, actually, which strangely puts me in the federally protected category of old. 40 and up is a federally protected.
I did not know that.
Definition category. Yeah. I didn't know either until it became relevant. I had to look it up. So I'm 42. I spent most of my 30s in full-time Buddhist practice. Prior to that, I had gotten a bachelor's degree in psychology. So I've been fascinated by psychology and psychotherapy, especially humanistic existentialist, since I was a teenager. When I was 18, I found out about Naropa.
Wow, so a long time ago.
Yeah, 1998. So since 1998, it was always my dream, and it was always like on the back burner. I'm like, if I'm ever done with this monk thing, I'm going to go to Naropa, get my master's, and just become a psychotherapist like I originally thought when I went to college. So it was on the back burner for a long time, but it was always kind of like the obvious choice because... Naropa is a legendary institution.
So I can relate with you there. I actually first heard about Naropa University while I was living and working at a Dzogchen retreat center in Northern California. And then it got lodged in the back of my mind for a few years. I didn't live in monasteries for as long as you did, but we have that in common, that an interest and passion for meditation, for the Buddhist teachings, for Dharma, eventually led us to going to Naropa.
Yeah.
Do you want to share a little bit about what got you interested in meditation and Buddhism and following the path of Zen?
Sure. It's one of those things that, well, notoriously, it's hard to say anything about Zen or about Buddhism in general. Just that I had a sense that there was more to life than meets the eye. As a teenager, there's got to be more to human potential. There's got to be more to I don't want to just rely on buzzwords like unsatisfactoriness and fleetingness of like day-to-day life of ordinary, life as it is ordinarily lived. But nonetheless, there was a pervasive, an itch that I couldn't even locate, let alone scratch. I started coming across human potential stuff in the form of like Abraham Maslow. And then at the same time discovered Taoism and Zen. This was when I was like 16 or 17. And I always took humanistic existential psychology and Zen to be aligned, definitely not doing the same thing, but definitely complementary. So for me, psychology and spiritual practice were always important. It's just a matter of like which one is on the front burner and which one is on the back burner at any time.
Yeah, I can appreciate that. I guess when I think about, I love existentialism philosophy too. And when I think about it in this context, it's kind of has this attitude of like, let's face reality, pain and all, suffering and all, and that will actually be better than trying to just have positive thinking or pretend things are okay or ignore that stuff.
Right. That you can't begin to heal if you don't. Well, the surgeon has to make a cut, right? It has to get better before it gets worse.
Yeah. Yeah. And I love the metaphor of the Buddha as a doctor dispensing Dharma, like the medicine, which heals our suffering, which is our disease, dis-ease, you know, not being at ease.
Yeah. And they're both logical. And
yeah, and that directly relates to a lot of what we're going to talk about. The Buddhist tradition is so rich in good logic and good conceptual thinking, how important that is.
Yeah. Clarity and insight. Right? Insight is like the most important thing. And I mean, we have the whole insight tradition now, or like insight is like the contribution that is being taken up by Western psychology now, or well, mindfulness, but hopefully mindfulness in service of insight, in service of seeing clearly what is. If we can't see clearly what is, then we just can't begin to do the work.
Yeah. 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 And so the ways that we understand the world and the ways that we think about the world and other people and ourselves, like, has a huge difference, makes a huge difference, and it impacts our emotions. And there's a feedback loop, right? Of if I see something and I understand it to be a negative thing and I focus on it, then I'm going to feel negative emotions about it, just to kind of generalize. But I think this is going to tie in a lot of what we talk about later.
Right. I'll make a mental footnote, microaggressions.
Yeah, microaggressions is a great example. So maybe we can dive in, because I wrote some notes. I was thinking about this. Part of the problem with the idea of microaggressions, it's not that that can't exist or that can't be true, but that as it's been commonly understood and used and talked about, like in universities like Naropa, it's often talked about in such a way where you're making an assumption about someone else's motivation and intention and their state of mind. And it's a negative one. You're perceiving hostility there. Like someone compliments your hair, that's a microaggression because your hair is different than, you know, other people's or something. And so you're starting to kind of conceptually create this world of increased hostility.
And you can't falsify it. If you go around with a presumption, so one of the wonderful things about, you could call it liberal society or free society or, you know, Western society, but really a free society, one linchpin of a free society is the legal presumption of innocence, which now we can use that at the moment as just a metaphor, or because we're not, microaggressions don't have to do with legal stuff. It's more psychological, but the presumption, nonetheless, the presumption of innocence is really an important, we should assume the best about people until we have evidence.
Yeah. I'm such a big believer in that. I think it's so important to give people the benefit of the doubt and to enact their goodness. And ironically, the Buddhist tradition teaches this so clearly, like to see, you know, we all have Buddha nature, for example, that we're all basically good, to give people, you know, that we're doing things, if we are causing harm, it's coming from a place of ignorance, you know, and if we actually understood, we would naturally choose to do the right things, the good things to bring about a better world. I mean, so part of the example of, if you perceive a microaggression and you don't actually know, you haven't actually asked the other person, like, are they coming from a negative place or not? And you're making that assumption. It's an example of what in cognitive behavioral therapy is called mind reading. You're making an assumption about someone else's mind. And that is a terrible, you know, mental habit. It's not a good leap of logic. It just creates more suffering in the world.
Right. And so it creates suffering. Like it's a bad idea socially in that it creates a hostile body politic and a hostile physical space of like a room full of people. It creates hostile a hostile social space, but also you're really, if you're going around thinking that way, you're putting yourself at risk for depression. And
yes,
I mean, very clearly.
Yeah.
You're yeah. Very powerfully.
Yeah. Yeah. It's true. Well, okay. I'm glad we're getting into it. So wind the clock back a little bit. Like you're there as a monk living in these monasteries, practicing meditation and doing that. And then Naropa's there in the back of your mind as a Buddhist inspired university, as a place where you could go and marry your, so to speak, bring together Buddhism with learning psychology, with becoming a therapist. And that's beautiful. And then you, I guess it was just a year ago, like last summer, you're applying to go to school there, right?
Yeah.
And then one of the amazing things about this, about your story with this, is you actually took the step of emailing the president of Naropa and I think another administrator. You emailed the school and you explicitly asked, right? Do you want to speak to that point? Asked about the social justice issues and that kind of thing.
Right. Well, I had, I only applied to Naropa. Actually, I applied to two schools, but I only interviewed with Naropa because I just only wanted to go to Naropa because it seemed like such a good fit. It was after I only applied to Naropa and after I was accepted to Naropa that I got red-pilled regarding woke, we'll call it critical social justice or wokeism.
Oh, interesting. So to explain that further, it's like from the Matrix, you get to choose, what is it, the blue pill or the red pill in that movie?
Yeah, well, I hope I'm using it right. Yeah. Not a big Matrix head, but I think the usage is red pill means like you see the truth.
Yeah. And so what exactly do you mean by that? Like that you woke up to the truth of the kind of woke far left ideology and its downsides?
So, right, exactly. So funnily enough, like I had been a radical activist throughout my 20s. In fact, part of my bona fides is that when I was 24, I co-founded a radical community space dedicated to educating and advocating for a world free of all forms of oppression and exploitation. So in my 20s, I was a radical activist. I actually moved to Portland for the anarchist scene.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that about you.
Part of it, yeah. When I was 27, which is funny because I just moved away from Portland because of
you know, it's interesting
because of the anarchist scene.
So we actually have that in common too, to some degree. Like I was pretty far left and something of an activist when I was like 19, 20, 21, 22, like in my early 20s. And I got arrested for protesting against the Iraq war, which is something that I'm still proud of today.
Yeah.
I went to multiple protests, but one of them was in San Francisco. And in order to clear everyone off the streets, at some point the police rolled in to this big crowd and sectioned everyone off in these little boxes with police holding riot shields. They made these human walls and made little like around little groups of people. And then they proceeded to arrest everyone in those little groups one by one. And then later all the arrest charges were dismissed, but it was a way to just clear the streets. It was wild. I'd never seen anything like it.
Yeah, totally. So, I traveled to New York City in 2003 to protest. What was it? It was to protest the RNC. George W. Bush was being nominated for his second term in the midst of the Iraq war. And I was arrested and thrown in jail for 3 days. Very strange. I actually ended up suing the NYPD and winning.
Oh, wow. For 3 days is a long time.
That's handling. I know, right? So I think it actually matters that that's where we're coming from, right? Like we care about social justice passionately. Because so many people, because critical justice, people who use the critical social justice, i.e. woke lens, they can't understand that it's possible to be a social justice advocate in a different way, with a different framework, with a different theory, right?
Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah, part of the what's happened in our society is this kind of slow takeover of this like really toxic ideology that we're going to get into more. But there's a lot of people like us that like, yeah, we support social justice. We support peace. We're against things like the war, generally speaking, the war in Iraq. I was against the war in Afghanistan, too. It was a disaster, you know. And so I don't fit anywhere on the political spectrum anymore. I'm not represented by any of these parties, the major Democrat or Republican party at this point. Right. You know,
I'm hearing that from everyone I talk to now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, but to get back on the timeline a little bit. So in my 20s, I was a radical activist. And, you know, to pretty extreme degree, I was also doing the sort of lifestyle anarchism of, I thought work was a scam and I hitchhiked across the country and things like that and lived on the streets for a bit in San Francisco.
Oh, wow.
Which I'm kind of, I'm not proud of now, but it's interesting. It was a great experience. But yeah, it was kind of like privileged tourism. But nonetheless, it gave me some firsthand experience.
You know, the original word for that's been translated as monk originally first came out of the Buddhist tradition, and it literally means homeless.
Yeah.
The Buddha was encouraging people to give up their home and just travel and live off what they received. They would just beg for food and they were homeless.
Absolutely. There's a different view from that position.
Yeah.
But by the time, again, I'm 42, by the time I was about 30, I was realizing that activism was pervaded by two things, by psychological immaturity. I'll just leave it at that. And spiritual, it was not merely disconnected from spirituality, but it was kind of antithetical to my spirituality in that the politics that I was that were available to me in Portland. But I mean, this goes for anywhere. I think it was just based on hatred. It was based on division and hatred and self-righteousness. We're right, they're wrong. F the pigs, you know, real basic, really basic. So there was a major life transition in my early 30s where, you know, I left Portland and explicitly left activism and left politics to pursue spirituality. And that's what I did for about 10 years until, you know, 2020. Then, okay, so right, this comes back to the red pill feeling. When I came back in 2020, of course, I didn't like Trump. And of course, Portland was a hotbed of Trump, anti-Trump protests. We had Homeland Security, this weird paramilitary crackdown in Portland. And I want to say the summer of 2021, I bought a gas mask and I went out and it was really like really intense.
I wonder if that was the summer of 2020 with the George Floyd protest and all that.
Maybe.
While Trump was still in office. Yeah.
Oh, 2020. Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was super intense. And I thought like, oh, I need to get back into it. This is a really important issue. Black Lives Matter, but also just the sort of increasing warning signs of totalitarianism by Trump, like the very real threat that he wouldn't leave office. So I'm like, okay, I actually got on Amazon and bought this like very anarchist black hat. That's like a particular kind of like anarchist black hat. You know, I got my black block clothes and I went out and man, the people on the street were just so venomous and hateful. The protesters.
Yeah.
That I never went back out.
That's so interesting.
And I'm thinking like, what's going on here? Because something was different, right? Something had changed. Like the activists of today, the left of today is not the left of 10 years ago. It's not the left of 20 years ago. And basically the word for it now is colloquially woke, or if you want to sound a little bit more technical, critical social justice. Now, critical social justice is, I definitely want to avoid getting into the rabbit hole of like analyzing it too much because I really can't. And there's so many better people to unwind all the layers, but critical social justice is fundamentally Marxist.
Right. That's an important point that I wanted to get to too. That's where it comes from, basically, is Marxism. And it's basically a worldview, right, where there's an oppressor class and then there's a victim class. And the victim class needs to fight against the oppressor class and overthrow them, potentially using violence. That's maybe some of the anger out there, right? And that's the worldview that that's being enacted. And it's not.
And it's black and white. You're with us or you're against us. And, you know, it's worth mentioning again here that black and white thinking is another one of those cognitive errors that leads to depression, right?
Yes, cognitive delusion. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, dichotomous thinking, black and white thinking, dividing people into evil or good. It's not a healthy way. It's not an accurate way to see the world where people.
Yeah. So when I applied to Naropa, I saw all this critical, all this diversity, equity, and inclusion stuff. And I'm like, yeah, great. It's really cool to see the school that I'm so invested in also being political. And shortly thereafter, it was basically through Benjamin Boyce's extensive YouTube documentary about the Evergreen affair. I think he calls it, it's like 13 or more parts on YouTube, the Evergreen story. Which is highly instructive. And there's actually a doctoral or maybe a master's dissertation talking about the whole Evergreen thing. Basically, some woke activists took over Evergreen and it was an utter fiasco.
Yeah, Evergreen is similar to Naropa, like a small private school, right? Very far left.
Right. And they created a position. They created a divided society on campus, a hierarchy of, you know, the good and bad people. And it's exactly what you would expect from woke politics in that queer people, people of color, and there's a ranking of people of color, like, you know, some people of color get more points than other people of color. But all these identities, disability versus ability and varying degrees of that.
It's like a dystopian nightmare, right?
Created this ranked hierarchy. And you actually had, and this is, you can see footage of it. There was this kind of gang of there was like a woke gang that was really terrorizing the campus. But at one point they were going around campus at night with baseball bats.
Wow. I don't know if I knew that part of it. Wow. That's
and scary. Intimidating people who disagreed with them.
I remember learning a bit about it and I'd like to learn more, but I remember there was like a moment where they trapped, I think, the president of the university and some faculty members in like a conference room and didn't allow them to leave until they agreed to certain things. It was just pretty wild stuff.
Yeah. So that was my red pill. And when I found out, when it clicked that, oh, that's what's going on. That is the current flavor or subspecies of activism. Like that's the activism that we're dealing with.
Yeah. And it's the dominant flavor at places like Naropa, unfortunately. Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, the whole world. I mean, that's the dominant flavor at Lowe's where they're doing, you know, whiteness trainings, apparently. at a hardware store, you know. And when I found out about that, I got very concerned. So I emailed the president of Naropa and the chair of the CPBP program.
Can you share with us what that stands for? This is the program you're applying for.
God, I hardly remember. I haven't said it in 6 months. You know, contemplative psychotherapy and Buddhist psychology?
Something like that, yeah. So it's the most Buddhist inspired of the psychology programs.
Yeah. And I scoured, I made copious notes. I read all the documentation online on Naropa's policies about academic freedom and, you know, diversity, like, what does diversity mean? Does diversity mean that we can have diversity of viewpoint diversity? Do we have free speech? Do we have, so basically, what are the policies around, like, what happens if I disagree?
Yeah,
with so politics.
I love that you emailed Naropa and explicitly asked this, and you shared those emails with me, and they're great. They're like, hey, I'm, you know, considering coming to school here. I want to check in that different viewpoints will be respected, something like that, you know, that you don't that you didn't personally agree with critical race theory and some of that stuff.
Yeah, and they gave me, you know, hedged, I think. I haven't read those responses in a while, but you know, I think they were like cautiously worded assurances.
I just read them and they were basically like, you can believe whatever you want and come here. And
yeah, I know Chuck Leaf said, you can certainly rely on our printed policies regarding academic freedom or something. So I'm like, okay, what choice do I have? I mean, I've done my due diligence. What more can I do? And so that brings us, I think, to Naropa.
Yeah, and so you say yes, you embark, you move to Boulder, Colorado, you start school there excited and hopeful, and it didn't last too long, but maybe.
No, and I was so open. What happened? I was so open, I was so ready. You know, my heart was so open.
Mm.
Yeah.
This is a field that, you know, pretty much everyone in it has a certain degree of idealism and optimism and the desire to help and to make a positive difference with their life. And it's not something people get into to earn a lot of money or to become famous, right? And going to Naropa costs a lot of money. There's a lot of student loans that many students there take on. And when they graduate, they're not offered real high-paying jobs. When I graduated, I got a job at a psychiatric severe mental health home and what's, you know, place, and it's a good place, but they were, you know, I started at 19 an hour with a master's degree. It was
an hour in my life. So.
Okay. Well, now I'm making a lot more, thankfully, but yeah. My point is, there's a sacrifice that's being made, and my heart goes out to people who are doing it, who are called to do this kind of work. It's to the work to become a healer in the world and to try to make a positive difference.
Yeah. So I thought I was the ideal candidate at the ideal school, perfect match. And the woke stuff gave me cause for concern, but nonetheless, I showed up fully. And I remember in the opening days, we did these like eye contact. We'd like wander aimlessly around the room, and then it was almost like musical chairs, and they'd say like, stop. And then like you'd turn to somebody and just like make eye contact in like, a minute, you know?
Nice.
And man, I just remember just being, having so much goodwill for the members of my cohort and just such goodwill, just overflowing, you know, metta, you know, loving kindness. And already in those opening days, we were also doing exercises where people were asked to sort themselves according to identities.
Wow. Okay. And so this was at the very beginning when you were first meeting people?
I think it was called the opening retreat or something.
Wow. I also experienced this when I went to Naropa for the master's in psychology program, and it was one of the first classes. And I'm just amazed at how poor a choice it is to begin a class like that, to begin not just a class, but a whole master's program, like, because it immediately is creating this like atmosphere of like noticing how different we are and like ranking people by privilege. And it's, to me, it's the opposite of how something like that should start, the opposite of seeing people with good faith and good intentions with positivity.
So it put me on guard. I was like, here we go, you know, because I knew that I was not going to participate in such activities, and that it would be, I don't know, like maybe possibly illegal to force me to participate in such activities.
Yeah.
I'm not sure about that. But for that activity that lasted for about half an hour, maybe, it was like, okay, enter the circle if you're non-binary, you know, mm-hmm. like, and then everyone who's not non-binary, like, stays out of the circle. It's like, enter the circle if you've been sexually abused. Oh, I wow. mean, it was yeah. a lot of it was like, enter the circle if you like cheese, right? Uh-huh. But then it was just kind of interspersed with these really heavy things. And also these really heavy, like, obvious identitarian categories of, like, enter the circle if you're gay, enter the circle if you grew up poor, whatever. And I just sat there and I sat on the floor cross-legged, silently opting out, because my spiritual practice is very clear about the pitfalls and perils of identifying.
Yes. Yeah. That's like cornerstone of Buddhism, right? The no yeah. self doctrine, right?
I mean, it's fundamental. It's so obvious. And here I am at a Buddhist university where I'm being asked to invest in these identities publicly.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm laughing so much. It's just, I think, a way for me to release.
Oh man, I mean, I laugh about it all the time.
Well, it takes a lot of strength for you to choose not to participate, especially at the beginning of something when you're first getting to know people. I can't imagine the strength it took for you to just sit
this
there.
This was like day two or day one. Yeah, it was the first time we interacted.
Well, so just to share briefly, one of my first classes, my first semester in the Master's of Psychology program was called something like Social Multicultural Foundations. And the teachers had us all stand in a line, a horizontal line, and then they would read a statement. And then if it was true for you, you would step forward. Or if the opposite was true for you, you would step back. And so it was something like, I'm a white person, you step forward. And then the people moving forward were the people who were more privileged. I'm a man, you step forward. I'm a woman, you step back. I'm non-binary, you step back. And so at the end of that, very lovely, you know, being sarcastic exercise, yeah. we had a room where we're physically divided. And then we all turned around and looked at the people at the very front of the room, you know, and I was up there and like, look at their privilege. Let's recognize their privilege. Let's all feel bad about it. And then there was this attitude of like, now we're going to have a group discussion and those privileged people shouldn't talk because they take up too much space.
Right. And that right there, I my mind just branched five ways of where something I could comment about how wrong that is.
So wrong, yeah.
And from a legal point of view, 100%, that is creating, so under Title IX, non-discrimination, any school that receives federal funding, including students attending the school receiving federal financial aid, right? Any school that receives federal funding has to abide by Title IX, which is non-discrimination based on sex in particular, right? But there are other protections for other federally protected class, such as race. It's like race, sex, I've forgotten age. Age is one of them. But these are federally protected classes in that you're protected from discrimination.
Right.
So what Naropa was doing with that exercise is it was providing a different educational experience for different people based on these classes. In other words, they were discriminating based on those on federally protected classes. So right there, that is in violation of a federal.
Yeah. I mean, I agree completely. And then, so I'm imagining like the other side, so to speak, the woke point of view is that it's actually not possible to be racist towards a white person, right? That's the part of the doctrine, the right. part of the ideology. And so from that perspective, since it's impossible to be racist towards a white person, you can, I don't know, do whatever you want or say whatever you want.
Right. And I had a new insight on that, which is that in one sense, it's fine for the woke people to hold that view. However, they cannot enact that view at a university that receives federal funding.
That's a good point. And so, yeah, part of the amazingness of this Title IX report that we'll get to is that it says that, right? It spells that out.
like if they want to have a woke university that is committed to racism against white people and sexism against against men and straightism against straight people, like they can do that, but it has to be a private university that does not receive federal funding.
Yeah, that's fascinating. Yeah, okay, fair enough. And I hope this podcast is a small, you know, however big or however small, like step to righting the wrongs here, right? To finding the balance and to speaking out against this kind of stuff, because it is so powerful and it has taken over in so many ways, so many different institutions and companies and of course universities. And it's not good. It's not right. Like you, I think the way you said it was so beautiful. Like if you want to hold these views, then that, you know, is okay. And we have free speech and we have freedom of thought. But you can't, you shouldn't be able to impose them and punish students who don't believe in them, you know, especially right. These more extreme woke ideology. That's it's really Marxist. And it's really, again, it's just so ironic that a Buddhist university is getting taken over by what comes from the Marxist tradition, when Marxism has caused so much destruction to Buddhism around the world, of course, especially in Tibet, right? The Chinese used these Marxist teachings to go in and destroy monasteries, destroy the monks and nuns, outlaw religion.
It's heartbreaking. I thought about this several months ago. Like it was like yet another gut punch when I realized Chogyam Trungpa, this Tibetan monk, has to flee. So the, you know, Maoist, Marxist, communist China invades his country, destroys the monasteries, kills a bunch of people. He has to flee with the clothes on his back to the West. He goes to England. He goes to Scotland. He comes to America. He finds this beautiful place in Boulder. He starts a Buddhist university, having fled Marxism. Not 50 years after.
Yeah.
He founds this university. The Marxists have taken over the university he founded. Yeah. This university with a Buddhist name, Naropa University.
Yeah, Naropa University, the great, you know, Indian Mahasiddha, Yogin, enlightened being, awakened being.
And another friend of mine, I think who was in my program, pointed out that every time we say Naropa, referring to the university, and we say it with disappointment, We're besmirching the name of the great Indian Saint Naropa.
Well, yeah, that's a good point. I'm going to make a point to say Naropa University, not Naropa. Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah, it's just sad. It's just sadness heaped upon sadness. And again, I always have to remind myself, why do I care about this? Why am I sad? Why am I angry? Because it's doing harm. Why am I talking to you now? Because harm is being done by Naropa University, and I want that harm to stop.
Yeah.
I forget that a lot. Sometimes I'm only stewing in hurt and anger, and I forget that I'm hurt and angry because I don't want this harm to continue.
Yeah. You know, it makes me think just briefly, there's a really beautiful teaching from Chogyam Trungpa Rinpoche in one of his books where he visited an elementary school, and there were these little kids there, and they asked him about communism, and was he angry? Did he want to fight back? And he said no. And he said the problem is just ignorance. And so Chogyam Trungpa Rinpoche was really teaching basic goodness, that we're all good. He was telling people to cheer up, to uplift themselves, to have a good time, to enjoy their life, right? So it's just more than ironic that what's happened there. Because another point that we could get into is this idea of all white people are racist. It's really, to me, very similar, connected to the idea of original sin, which is the opposite of the Buddhist teachings around basic goodness. But it's this sense that, like, because you're American, because of the color of your skin, there's this evil, there's this sin that you're like born into and you have to live with your whole life, and you can never fully wash off, and you're just supposed to like feel bad about it and apologize for existing or something like that, right? It's a toxic ideology.
Absolutely. I agree with you 100%. I believe it was John McWhorter that recently published a book called Woke Racism that I haven't read. But I think his framework for the book is, one, that woke is racism. And some are calling it neo-racism as a catchy way. But if you look at the thought of Robin DiAngelo in particular, and I think maybe she's been canceled now, but you know, she's the high priestess. She's the original high priestess of some of the woke religion, and it is 100%. It follows the Catholic template 100%, except there's no redemption.
Oh, it's even worse.
Yeah. It's Catholicism without Jesus. The only thing a white person can do is embark on a lifelong, actually a lifelong subordination and shame.
Whew, man.
Yeah. And so to make the claim, I just want to be so clear, because some people have never, you know, that spark has just never leapt the gap, to make the connection that when you, if you say all white people are X, Y, or Z, whatever the X, Y, or Z is, but especially, or maybe only, if X, Y, or Z is a negative thing, then that is that is racism. That is a racist claim.
Yes.
So if you say all white people are racist, that is a racist claim, period. That is racism. Period. Full stop.
Yeah. Well, so I want to get back to your story. Like, you're, when you started this program, and this, the programs in Europe are different, but this one you're in starts off with a kind of meditation retreat where the cohort is all there together to get to know each other, and you're immediately realizing you're in this kind of atmosphere of wokeness.
Sure. Actually, there's some leading up to that. Sure. So there is a young woke professor, PhD, at Naropa. And let's see how to tell the story. It's very simple, actually. So this person is very like out front about having woke politics. It's obvious in a variety of ways in their presentation. This person uses they, them pronouns. So they were giving a simple lecture on foundational theories of psychotherapy. I mean, we're talking like cognitive behavioral psychotherapy, Freud, maybe we mentioned Jung, maybe we mentioned, they mentioned some humanistic existential, Carl Rogers, Viktor Frankl, whatever. Frequently in this lecture, they kept saying, well, they're an old white man. Now, obviously, it's a factual statement that Carl Rogers, once he became old, he was an old white man, right? Like that is factually true. I'm not clear on why that was relevant. And M told me in the email that followed that, you know, it's important to highlight social positions. What are we calling them? You know, positionality.
Your identity.
Social locations.
Social location. Yeah.
Social locations in terms of power, privilege, and oppression. Okay. Especially if we're going along with the ACA emphasis on critical social justice. ACA requires instructors to infuse, they use the word infuse, these issues into instruction. Okay, we can do that. However, that professor, one couldn't help, like an impartial observer couldn't help that they were saying old white men as a derogatory, as a critique.
Right. They're not making a factual statement. It's a derogatory critique. And I guess from their point of view, it matters because that tells you, it's supposed to tell you so much about the mind or the intentions or the character of someone, right? Or where they're coming from. Or,
right.
It's like bad the things. Most important thing in the woke ideology.
It's
like
telling you race. Bad things about the mind, character, abilities of these old white men who invented psychotherapy.
Carl Rogers must be, he's like, of all the people to try to pick on, he's such a nice, gentle, loving person.
I know. I mean, don't even get me started on the lack of gratitude, the lack of, because these people, woke activists, are very clear that they want to dismantle, disrupt, they want to destroy the field and replace it with a Marxist version. They actually want to, because as we discussed earlier, like cognitive behavioral therapy is very clear that these woke tactics are counter-therapeutic, that woke tactics hurt people psychologically, harm. So they just want to throw out cognitive behavioral therapy and replace it with, a social revolutionary therapy that will validate people's struggle, but not give them any tools to get better. Okay, so I'm drifting a little bit, but basically this professor repeatedly made derogatory comments about old white men, quote, old white men, unquote. And also I noticed as this long class, I think it's like a 2 or 3 hour long in-person class progressed, I noticed that students were starting to say old white men in related phrases with the same derogatory.
Social contagion.
Yeah. So this woke professor was normalizing, I believe the word is misandry, like misogynism, misandry, I think.
Okay.
Hatred of men.
So you're definitely obviously not the first person to notice that at Naropa, that men are made the punching bags and are torn down and are blamed and are, yeah, so.
Is now a good time for you to talk about that? Some of the context that led you to be receptive to my...
I want to keep coming back to your story because it's amazing, but okay. Yeah. I mean,
however you want to pace it. I don't know. I have no idea what time it is.
So. Yeah. Let me, so my story with it is interesting in the sense that I first went to Naropa University for the Master's in Buddhist Studies program in 2008. Okay. And this was before this woke takeover stuff happened. And so it just wasn't there. And then I'm meditating and I'm working as a coach and I started a tutoring company, blah, blah, blah. But I decided to go back to school to become a therapist. Which I feel great about now. I'm in a good place with it and I love this work. And so when I went back to Naropa, it was 2016 and the election of Trump had just happened, which I think is a big part of the bigger story here that made people go kind of crazy in opposition to it. And so I entered this, I entered Naropa not realizing how powerful I'm using the word woke ideology. I don't know what else they call it. The critical race theory, all that stuff had become. And, I was just in those waters and it took me a while to start to wake up to what was going on because I was my whole life been left, left leaning person voting for liberals or Democrats or the Green Party or whatever. And it took me some time to realize like, well, it's not okay to say things like old white men or to make assumptions about me or anyone else on the basis of your race or age or gender or sexual orientation or, just because someone is white and heterosexual and a male doesn't mean that they don't have something valuable to say, or doesn't mean that, we don't need to interpret everything they say through those lens. This is ridiculous. What's happening here? And, but part of the point, so part of what I can share is just so many conversations with so many other male students at Naropa who all shared some version of some story of feeling, discriminated against, to use that word, because they're men. And, so that's been a long ongoing issue, I think, with Naropa and the psychology programs. And I have particular stories of, I knew several fellow male students who dropped out like you did. I know several who had to take an extra year to graduate, which is a tremendous amount of time and money if you think about the cost of Naropa University. And in their stories of why they had to take an extra year, there was an element of, this kind of anti-male bias, Like this one student I know was accused by another group of students of cheating, of plagiarizing on a paper. And in his telling of it to me, he felt like they were against him partly because he was like the white heterosexual guy in the room and didn't agree with all the social justice stuff when that would come up in class. So he felt kind of like alienated and targeted. then they accused him of cheating on this paper, and there was this big investigation, and he was put on some kind of suspension or leave, and then it was found out that he didn't plagiarize that paper, and then the teacher or administrators or whoever was doing this investigation kept investigating, and then they discovered, and so he thought he was exonerated, and then they discovered that he had written a discussion post for the classroom discussion, and that he had then copied and pasted his own words, his own discussion post, for a paper, a later paper in a class, and that was called plagiarism, and then he was officially suspended. He chose to stay. He took a whole extra year to graduate, and these students who had accused him of cheating, originally, their original accusation was actually false, but they never had any negative consequences. They never had to apologize to him. They never had to, nothing bad at all happened to them. So that's one example. And there's more. I could go on, but
I'm speechless. I don't know what to say. It's shocking, but not surprising, or whatever. There's a clever phrase for that. It never stops being shocking, even after the surprise wears off. You know, you could. I wonder what the limit is to what Naropa University will do to sort of pile up and gang up on people who go against the ideology.
You're the only one I've met who filed a complaint. I mean, I guess we're going to get to that in your story. And you're the only one who like your story of refusing to participate in that activity, I think speaks to your character and to a certain inner strength in you. And maybe all your years in the monasteries meditating helped you get there. But so, you know, credit to you for that.
Thank you. It's important to tell the truth. I can't, it's hard for me to remain silent. So here we are.
Yeah.
However, remember in that report, it does mention, I don't know if we should use her name, the former Title IX coordinator at Naropa University. She mentions in the report that we'll eventually get to that in her tenure as Title IX coordinator, 100% of the complaints, formal complaints filed to the Title IX office for the entire university, 100% of the discrimination complaints came from men in the CPBP program.
That's amazing. 100% of the complaints come from men.
In the CPBP program, which is a small graduate program in Naropa University.
Yeah, it's a small
program. They at any given time, they have maybe 100 students, three cohorts. So less than 100 students in a university. Maybe it's 10% of the student body, the CPBP program. And yet it accounted for 100% of the formal Title IX complaints. So other men were filing Title IX complaints.
Your program was particularly bad in this way. And one of the advantages of your program that made me almost want to jump into it was it has a very strong cohort model of 30 or 40 people when you do those retreats together and you have all your classes together and you really get to know the other students, you know, so you have that more community aspect, which is,
oh my God. Yeah. Turns out, especially when you have Gen Z folks, who have been raised on fragility instead of resilience, and who have not been raised with freedom of speech or diversity of viewpoint. When you have a cohort saturated with groupthink, turns out cohort model's not so great.
There is a lot of downsides to the community, yeah, especially if you get ostracized or kicked out of a community.
So here's how I got ostracized. It's such a simple story of hysteria, right?
Can we go back to your refusing to participate in that opening weekend retreat in that exercise? Like, what happened after that? Like, did you feel like people were starting to turn against you then, or hold that?
So after the old white man thing, I sent that professor a very gentle email saying, you know, I understand what you're trying to do, but you could be in violation of law and policy, of Naropa University policy, as well as federal law. And they were not receptive to my my concern. Instead, they were like, you know, no, you need to be, the issue here is that you need to be fostering awareness of your privilege and power as an old white man. So I kind of changed my tone and I said, just to be clear, I'm warning you that you're in violation of federal law and Naropa anti-discrimination policy. Then I was very promptly called into a disciplinary meeting with the department chair.
Hmm.
That disciplinary meeting, so it's crystal clear in the non-discrimination policy of the university itself that's called retaliation. When you suffer a negative consequence for raising a concern about discrimination. So I was being retaliated against for saying, hey, I'm concerned about discrimination. So there we had discrimination, which is a sort of violation. And then keeping and sort of multiplying the severity of the offense is further retaliation based on my complaint.
Hmm.
So we have discrimination and retaliation. Crystal clear paper trail. It's all there in the emails and everything. So then I took, okay. So I'm like, okay. So I go to the mandatory meeting on Zoom. And I was very upfront. I was like, look, critical social justice encourages racism, et cetera. And it's 100% okay to examine the roles of race, gender, et cetera. It's very important in a therapy training program to investigate how my worldview impacts my relationship to clients. 100% super important. However, the way you're approaching this is in violation of not only federal law, but also Naropa's own policies.
I appreciate how careful you are with your words and in the emails that you shared with me, how you know, careful and polite and factual.
I'm really glad it comes off that way. I even myself sometimes I have a hard time not coming off as a smug asshole. So I'm glad to hear you say that. I'm sure some people still think I sound like a smug asshole. Hey, I'm trying. I'm trying my best.
But the bigger point here is whatever perception other people have of you or however you come across, we have freedom of speech. We should have diversity of opinions. It should be okay. You should be able to attend a graduate school, and like you're saying, one that receives federal funding, and express your opinion too, right? It's not... Right.
Yeah. And I think that, again, I'm trying my best to stay focused, but one of the problems we're facing with this whole issue is that these folks, neither the students nor at this point the instructors, who are by and large very young and inexperienced, well, maybe 50-50, there's some elders there too, but they don't know what a university is. The students don't know what a university is. I had the benefit of doing my undergrad over 20 years ago, so I know what a university is. If you're 24 or even 30, maybe your only experience of university is it's an indoctrination camp. It's an ideological factory. Mm,
that's terrible.
It's radical teachers producing radicals, and that's well documented in like Jonathan Haidt's book. God.
Yeah, the Coddling of the American Mind, right?
Yes.
Fantastic book. Right. So whereas the university is supposed to be and should be and used to be a place of different viewpoints, opinions, perspectives, and let's consider them and let's stretch our intellectual capacity and see what's out there. And now, like, yeah, I mean, a lot of professors and I guess administrators now too are explicitly ideological, that they are trying to enact this great social justice reform against this white supremacist society. And if you question that, then you're a racist and, you know, that's not allowed.
I think they believe it's their moral imperative to seize institutional power in order to force their ideology at any cost onto the world.
Yeah, it's scary. Well, so, okay, let's go back to your story and get through that, and then we can talk more about all these issues. Okay. So you wrote these emails, and then what happened?
So I had this like mandatory meeting with the original professor plus the department chair. I expressed my views, and the department chair made this odd comment a few times. She kept saying, "Well, we're at an impasse." And I didn't know what it meant at the time. I'm like, that's an odd thing to say. Well, then we're at an impasse. I'm like, I'm not at an impasse. I'm in dialogue here. I'm telling you that you're violating the law and policy. And I'm telling you that I'm willing to talk about these things. Then it's perfectly... it's very important, actually, to talk about positionality and things like that, and racism and sexism, et cetera. Let's talk about those things, but let's talk about them in class in ways that don't violate the law, that aren't discriminatory or racist. I really didn't understand what she meant by we're at an impasse. Sorry, I will get to the retreat. Eventually, it dawned on me that what it meant was that the impasse was that they would set up an impenetrable roadblock for me moving forward in the program. What they meant was, you're done in this program.
Oh,
that
geez.
Was the impasse. So, but it took me a long time to figure that out. So a few days after, again, I came in bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, looking people in the eye, in a sea of bliss, albeit with some trepidation about like these sorting yourself by identities exercises and being highly attuned to possible problems. But I started the discussion with that professor, fully expecting a rational response. Move forward. A few days later, I had been just like totally shot down and invalidated by the department chair, prior to which I had extreme respect for, and I really wanted to work with her because she works with the psychedelic studies stuff. I'm like, oh, I really like this person. They just totally shot me down.
Hmm.
A couple days later, I'm supposed to go to Maitri One, a retreat deep in the mountains of Colorado. It's like a 2 week, I think it's 2 weeks. Is it 1 week or 2 weeks? Do you know?
I'm not sure. That wasn't enough.
I think it's 2 weeks. Yeah. Honestly,
I think they used to be 3 weeks, but
maybe, I don't know how long it is. But so it's like this cloistered, so it's kind of a meditation retreat. It's kind of a therapy retreat. It's kind of a team building. We're all going to meld as one, as a cohort, right? So it's a little bit culty. And I had just gotten the rug pulled out from under me from the leadership of the program.
Hmm.
And
specifically the meeting you had with them. Like where they said you were at an impasse and
I had the professor with whom I had the conflict was at the retreat. So I just felt extremely uncomfortable. I felt like I was behind enemy lines. I felt like I was trapped in the mountains with a bunch of crazy people. and and that the people chaperoning the event, I mean, there were a ton of instructors, faculty on hand, but I felt like they were part of, I could only assume that they were members of the department that had just, I don't know a concise word for it, that had just destroyed me or whatever.
Huh. Yeah. I'm sorry. I don't mean to laugh. It's just such a situation. Cause I imagine at that meeting, what you really wanted to hear was like, you're allowed to have your viewpoint. You know, you're not,
right.
You're not expressing a racist view that's like going to cause harm. You're saying something that's pretty mainstream, pretty common sense, pretty normal.
Right. And that person at the meeting was the very department chair or whatever who had assured me in the email prior to my coming that I was free to, you know, have my own thoughts about how best to proceed with anti-racist activism, etc. Yeah. And then they basically took my money and told me that if I didn't get on board with their ideology, I was canceled.
Wow.
So I felt kind of panic attacky. I spent the night in the mountains at the retreat. And then in the morning, I just felt it in my body that I couldn't participate in that.
Hmm.
So I left, packed my car and I left. And from that moment forward, so the cohort was greatly disrupted. The
cohort leaving?
Who by and large act out fragility rather than resilience, and they act out victim roles, and they tended to act out really child roles throughout my experience with the cohort. I disrupted the retreat by leaving, right? So a significant number of the cohort then sort of painted me as somebody who had harmed the cohort by not participating in the retreat.
Hmm.
Like I was doing harm and that I had like breached something. Because they, by and large, the attitude in the cohort was not that we were a bunch of independent adults, sort of side by side, kind of collaboratively, but ultimately independently embarking on this training program. But rather, we were some kind of like fused, enmeshed group of children that owed each other some kind of something. I'm never quite sure what we owed them except coddling. We owed each other coddling.
Wow.
But that my very decision to leave this hostile environment, and that's actually a technical term, hostile educational environment. So discrimination can create a hostile educational environment. So they did create a hostile educational environment for me, and by my own, you know, by my own experience, it felt hostile to me. So then I left, and by leaving, many members of the cohort felt that I was somehow, that was the beginning of them ostracizing me. It was very strange. And from there, it really deteriorated. Like they grew hostile to me because I was not endorsing their groupthink.
Yeah, so I mean, part of what I'm hearing you say is there wasn't a sense of permission to, you know, be there by choice, and you know, understanding if you wanted to leave and why, and dialogue around it.
Yeah, it was very culty. It's like, why aren't you doing the thing that we're all doing? You're harming us. I mean, I'm kind of repeating myself, but it's very strange. It's very strange, but it isn't strange if you look at it like a cult rather than like a university.
Well, I mean, I'm trying to think, I mean, to kind of like look at the other side or sides, but it's part of the program and part of like an important class, so to speak, that you're supposed to do to complete the program. But I totally understand what you're saying. You should have choice. You should be able to be there or not. And you're that, again, to use that word, basic goodness or who you are as a person, shouldn't judge you if that's what was best for you to do.
Yeah.
And then of course there shouldn't be this ideological component to it. It shouldn't be, here's, you know, without you agreeing to that ahead of time, which you explicitly weren't on board with from the beginning.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's heavy. Wow. So you leave, and then I guess at that point you feel more outside of the group, right? Because you've left the group.
Yeah. Yeah. At that point, by leaving that retreat, it made it academically impossible for me to continue the program. Because it was a required course that couldn't be repeated. So yeah, that was it. In leaving that retreat, based on the hostility I felt, I left the program. However, I actually tried to withdraw from Naropa University at that point, but I had just missed the deadline and I would have had to pay $10,000 out of pocket.
Wow.
In order to withdraw.
A lot of money.
Yeah. Which, yeah, obviously, maybe not obviously, but I don't have $10,000 just to withdraw from a hellscape. So I actually had to finish the semester where it had been established that the faculty were hostile to me and that the cohort was increasingly hostile to me as well.
So when you say hostile, do you want to give more examples around that? Or is it a general atmosphere that you were feeling? Were there specific comments made?
Regarding the cohort, based on like these really minor and perceived infractions or perceived slights, microaggressions, right? Basically, based on microaggressions and my refusal to enter their frame of reference, the cohort started turning against me, like, oh, this happened with this person and this thing happened with this other person. So, and then because it's a cohort and because they're really enmeshed and things like that, there, I think I got the sense it was very like gossipy. People basically stopped making eye contact with me.
Wow. Okay.
In person. So they shunned me. It was a shunning. So I would go to class and no one would make eye contact with me. No one would smile.
Like no one would say hi to you or how are you doing? That kind of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's significant.
Yeah. And then we had a lot of group discussions, small group discussions where people would just want to talk about things that I had said or, you know, these offenses. Like I was racking up offenses.
Wow.
By, you know, anything that wasn't compatible with critical social justice.
And part of this was there were some discussion board posts on a website that you did that were students found offensive.
Right. So I don't know how much you want to go into that. How much?
Well, I wonder. I'm just imagining from the point of view of someone listening to this, like if there is an example or two that comes to mind around something you did or said that was perceived as so offensive as to deserve a group discussion about it.
Sure. Well, an early offense was that in a small discussion. So a bit of background, I had 20 years ago, I started a master's degree in religious studies. I didn't complete it because I'd rather do religion than study it. But I took some graduate courses in religious studies, including reading Edward Said's Orientalism.
Oh, yeah.
So I knew something about Orientalism. And in a small group, we talked about Orientalism. And I talked about it from an academic point of view. And then I talked about Orientalism from an academic point of view. And apparently I offended somebody with that, which shocked me. It just utterly shocked me because it was like one of the greatest speeches of my life. It was about how, you know, East and West are ultimately both trying to use each other's complementary and parallel sort of streams of cultural development to to benefit, you know, oh, we can learn from Tibet, Tibet can learn from us, etc. Really basic stuff. And I thought it was I was kind of proud of my.
Yeah, and shockingly, that's very offensive because it's not going along with that woke ideology that all the oppressors are white European, you know, descendants who are oppressing everyone else. And
exactly.
The idea that some other culture could actually benefit from something that came out of Western Europe is so offensive in that environment.
and so people started telling me, oh, so-and-so is offended by what you said. You need to talk to so-and-so. And I'm like, well, if they want to talk to me about it, they can approach me. Finally, I emailed so-and-so and I said, people are telling me I should talk to you. And they say, kind of understandably, well, if you only want to talk to me because people are telling you you need to talk to me, that's an additional offense, right?
Oh, wow. So we're at about the level of sixth graders at this point.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I'm like, you know, if you ask me point blank, I'd say, yes, that's the reason why I want to talk to you is because people are telling, because I want to, because I'm willing to do this thing that people want me to do, right? To create some harmony. However, then this person who felt offended by my Orientalism thoughts said, well, you need to, they couched it in positionality terms. They said, it's okay, let's talk, but it's your job to listen. I'm going to talk and you're going to listen. And I said, no, I'm entirely willing to have a human encounter with you and to discuss our different points of view about Orientalism and your experience of what I said and my experience of what I said. And I'm entirely willing and available to have an authentic human encounter. But no, I'm not going to accept a subordinate role.
Yeah, that's to your credit. Wow, you spoke up against that. That's such a dominant part of the atmosphere at Naropa that I experience and many other people I've talked to have experienced that is really, it doesn't sit right with me. And it's damaging to people. Like you're saying, I think it's damaging to everyone because it's just, you know, it's not a human conversation at that point.
It's not a conversation. It's a monologue.
Well, so I just want to add here, like, if, you know, people are listening and like you're telling your story, which I appreciate. And then maybe they're wondering, well, he's saying it was a hostile environment. Maybe it was, maybe it wasn't. I don't know. The fact is you filed a complaint with the Title IX office and they investigated and talked to people and they produced a report that is extraordinary. And it 100%, 1,000% exonerates you. That it agrees with what you're saying, that you were, that it was a hostile environment, that you were discriminated against for these reasons. So I just want to put that in there for the listener to make sure people get that point because it's important.
Right. Yeah, really, really good point. Good timing, I think. Because, yeah, as you said, this is just my point of view until you bring in the professional, the lawyer who is acting as the Title IX coordinator. Right. So anyway, that email exchange about the comments I made about Orientalism from an academic point of view, having studied Orientalism at a master's degree level, circulated in the cohort. That person's offense was it circulated and percolated and contributed to, like, people. They shunned me. That's one example. Yeah. That was a powerful turning point where I became a problem, or like contributed to me being perceived as a bad person to be shunned, and probably racist, you know.
Oh man, yeah. I'm sorry to hear that happen to you. And I think part of what I see is that that kind of atmosphere makes a lot of people not actually speak their truth, not actually share what they really think, and that's not good. That's again unhelpful, or at its worst harmful. And so there's probably a lot of people in your situation at school there and at similar schools who just don't say anything, and they just kind of go along with it. But it doesn't make it right. It doesn't make it good.
Right. It quickly became clear that my voice was absolutely unwelcome.
Yeah.
People would sigh if I said something, or, you know, sometimes people would yell at me in class in front of everyone.
Jeez.
And that behavior was normalized because like really unprofessional and childish behavior was implicitly endorsed if anger was being expressed like by woke people, right?
Mm-hmm.
So like if a woke person screamed at somebody in class, then that the norm established in the cohort and by the instructors was perfectly acceptable.
That's a good point. So I want to share one example of another male student in Europa that I knew who had to take an extra year to graduate. They were in the classroom and there was some kind of quiz, and they were filling out their quiz and someone made some noise and the door got open. And so there's some like disturbance, and that bothered them because they were focusing on this quiz, and they made some kind of sound expressing anger, and they kind of like hit their desk a little bit. And they're telling of it to me like it wasn't like a big thing, but they did some kind of movement where they kind of hit their desk and like sighed loudly or something like that. And that incident of them expressing anger in that way became the reason for them to take a whole extra year to graduate, because Naropa, you know, didn't think they were qualified, or that they weren't mature enough, or blah, blah, blah. And it just seems like another example of, to put it bluntly, a white heterosexual male being treated differently than someone who of different identities would have been treated.
Absolutely. So it turns out like that, oh God, I told myself I wouldn't say like, I've probably said it 600 times and not even noticed, but that person who complained about my Orientalism ideas, I believe they went to some teachers, some professors, instructors, what have you, and complained about my conduct. And that ended up going on my record. And they, I believe it was couched in terms of like, I was harming them. I was an oppressor.
Right.
And we need to remember, anytime you see privilege, it means oppressor. Because the...
Good point.
The pair, the logical pairing, so privilege and oppressed is not a logical pairing. Hmm. Oppressor and oppressed is a logical pairing.
Yes.
So privilege is always shorthand. It's always a euphemism for oppressor. So I was being an oppressor. Hmm. And that person actually had themselves removed from my small group based on all of that.
Yeah.
And it sort of went into my file as, yet again, I'm oppressing and harming these people.
Right. That's a good example. And it's a good segue to go back to that book, The Coddling of the American Mind, which by Jonathan Haidt. It's a great book. It talks about some of these issues. In that book, he outlines three great untruths. Mm. And one of them we talked about is the untruth of fragility, the untruth that what doesn't kill you will make you weaker. And it's this kind of safetyism, trying to keep you safe, trying to avoid discomfort. So if someone says something and that bothers me, then I'm no longer safe, quote unquote, even though your physical safety is there, but you've been emotionally damaged in some way. And the oppressor person has oppressed you. Some version of that. But another part of that The second great untruth in that book is the untruth of emotional reasoning. Always trust your feelings. And then the third one was the untruth of us versus them. Life is a battle between good and evil people, which we already kind of talked about, that dichotomous thinking. But the second one is particularly pertinent to Naropa University, where I think in a kind of reaction against the dominant culture, which values, you know, conceptuality a lot, there's this big emphasis on emotionality and like listening to your feelings and getting in touch with them. And that can be healing. It can be good, but it can also be dangerous because sometimes our emotions are based on things that aren't true. And just trusting your feelings all the time doesn't tend to work out very well. It tends to lead to impulsiveness and to this kind of emotional ups and downs and all this stuff. You know, we know that, right? So
well said, well said. And that if I often remind myself to back up and ask myself, what are my values? Real simple: wisdom and compassion. Wisdom. What do I mean by wisdom? Clarity. Again, this goes back to what we opened with a little bit. Clarity is seeing what is. Clear seeing. Now, emotionality, well, it reminds me of the Buddha's five similes about the, I think it's five similes. You know, anger is like dropping in red dye into a clear pool. You want a clear pool so you can see clearly. Or, oh gosh, I've forgotten. But, you know, like one emotion is obscures seeing to the bottom of the pool. I think anger might be boiling water or something. You know, you can't see clear to the bottom through boiling water, and lust maybe is the red dye or something. So it's, again, so obvious it hardly bears saying, but unfortunately we're in a position where we have to say what's wrong with emotionality. What's wrong with emotionality is that it's not accurate.
Yeah.
If we live based on our emotions, we'll be disconnected from what is.
Yeah. 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 I mean, of course, the flip side, we don't want to repress or deny our emotions, but, you know, want to distinguish, like, are they accurate? Are they based on what's real? You know, are they helpful? Is there an intuition happening here, or am I reacting to something that I'm imagining? It might not even be there. Like, I'm like the classic example in Buddhism is you're walking down the path and you see something and you think it's a snake and you have fear. And then you realize it was a stick on the ground that you mistook for a snake. So the whole emotionality and fear reaction was just based on delusion. Right?
And if you say, I felt unsafe when I saw that stick, therefore the stick harmed me. Well, that's pretty interesting.
Oh man. Yeah. It's just, we're coming back to the Buddhism, especially, which I love. And
especially if the stick is a person.
Yeah. Yeah. And especially if the thing about that person that's harming you is something that that person doesn't have any choice about. Like, they don't believe people choose the color of their skin or even their sexual orientation. And so to hold that, or their gender or their sexuality, like to hold that against them.
Yeah. If you believe that, if your ideology takes this as axiomatic that white people are harmful oppressors. And this is why we need to really recommit as a society to presumption of innocence, not just as a legal principle, but as a principle of getting along with one another.
Yeah. Well, so to get back to your story there, you filed the complaint and there was this investigation. And I mean, eventually, of course, you did leave the university. And yeah, at the end of that, the report, which I think I'll read in the intro because I think that'll frame this whole conversation, or read some excerpts from it. But at the end, it says you were discriminated against and recommends that you be recompensated for your money, for the tuition that you spent.
Right.
I'm guessing none of that ever happened.
Sorry.
So you got back from, or you left the retreat, you're back in Naropa to finish out the semester?
Yeah.
At that point, are you thinking like, maybe I can still get some credit for these courses if I transfer somewhere else, or what is your thinking like?
Yeah. I couldn't, what was it? In order to withdraw with it not sabotaging my academic record, I would have to pay $10,000. I think that was the deal. Like, or No, it was, I'm sorry. We can maybe even cut this part out. But regardless of my academic record, it would cost me $10,000 to withdraw, because it was at this critical juncture where if I left, they would return my student loans to the federal government and I would have to pay the university out of pocket. It was like, because I withdrew, then I no longer qualified for the federal loans I had already received.
Oh, okay.
And so...
So you made the choice to finish out the semester there.
Yeah, yeah. And yeah, I do... I still intend to transfer what credits I can. I don't know ultimately if any of them will transfer, because Naropa University is not well accredited. So we'll see, but yeah. I may be able to transfer some credits, but primarily I was just sort of financially coerced. No, that's to put it too strongly, but I had to stay, and it was just increasingly hostile from the cohort. I kept being required by assignments, and this is where the discussion posts come in. I don't know if we'll get to them. I was required to write discussion posts on these woke pieces.
Yeah.
And I decided to be honest because, like I said earlier, I just kind of have to be.
So at this point, you're already alienated from the cohort and you're going to be honest with these posts. So I can just see kind of how the divide is growing.
Oh, yeah. It was extreme.
Did you have some friends in the cohort or some people you felt were on your side, so to speak, or supportive?
I did. Little by little, allies reached out to me. And little by little, those allies who were trying to remain stealthy so they wouldn't receive the harsh treatment that I was receiving. They were trying to keep their thoughts private, but they outed themselves inadvertently, little by little. And as they did so, they started to receive the same extreme reactions from the cohort that I did.
Oh. Interesting. And, you know, I thought of something I wanted to ask you. This cohort, is it maybe 30, 40 people? Like, what is the kind of general makeup, since we're talking about all this identity stuff? Is it mostly white people? I'm guessing mostly women. Do you want to speak to that at all?
Yeah. I don't remember precisely, so I'll give...
Yeah.
Really vague, you know, don't quote me on this. I think we started with 33 or so, mostly white, a few people of color. I'd say 10% people of color, 10-15%, maybe 4 people of color. And how do we define people of color? How do they define themselves? Yeah. I don't know.
How many men?
Something like that. Men, well, majority women. I always felt like there were very few men, but it seems like when I would add it up, there were more than I thought. It just felt like there were few because...
Maybe because they were keeping quiet.
They weren't the dominant voices in the room. There were a lot of men. Some of, to me, the most interesting, experienced... and wise men in the cohort they just didn't say anything.
So
what were we talking about?
Well, you got back from the retreat and you were being honest in these posts, and you had some people who were expressing support to you privately, but they didn't want to do it publicly.
I ended up with a small group of basically 2 supporters who were women. And honestly, if I could take that back, I would, because I do not think it's helpful to specify social locations of people like so automatically. Sometimes it's relevant.
Right.
But in this case,
good point. It doesn't have to be relevant. It's not relevant all the time.
Yeah.
And we're, whoever we are, we're more than just that. We're more than just those identities.
Right. I'm just buying into that framework by making it front of mind.
I guess the part of the point in my question is that in my experience at Naropa, it is mostly white people, of people who have some amount of economic support, often from their families, right, to be able to afford it. And it's mostly women. It's like, you know, I think the graduate psychology programs are about 70-80% women on average at Naropa. And then the whole field of psychology is something like 70-80% women. I've looked at the numbers. I don't remember them all off the top of my head, but it's...
And, you know, I'll throw in a little data point here that I just became familiar with the work of Dr. Warren Farrell. He wrote The Boy Crisis, along with a lot of other important works about the deteriorating state of boys and men in the Western world, actually. Like really poor educational outcomes. College in general, university in general, is massively female dominated. And then the boys and men who do go to university have like 50%, I think, of the completion rate as women.
Wow. I should look that up again. I've looked at that in the past, but I know that it's trending in a negative direction, and I know that men commit suicide more often than women.
That was the next data point I had there. Really, really, like four times the suicide rate in their 20s, I think. The rates are really based on age.
And to think that those trends that you're discussing are somehow totally divorced from all these topics we're talking about, you'd be crazy, right? They're definitely related, because men are being told that they're the oppressors. That's going to have a negative effect. It does do damage, and part of that damage is... You're taking a generalized statement, historically, culturally, may or may not be true, we could debate it, but then you're putting it on an individual. The individual is a unique person. We don't know that person, their mind, their intentions, their background. So one other example from Naropa that I can share is a fellow student in my cohort who started the program with me was an Army veteran, right? He'd served in the armed forces. He was there on student loans. In fact, a student loan program that was specifically for veterans that pays for higher education for them. And we were in that first class together doing that lineup exercise, and he wound up at the front of the room along with me and a couple other guys, and he said that, you know, basically, he didn't say this out loud at the time, but I talked to him later. So basically, like, that's bullshit. Like, I come from what's called a broken family. I've worked hard my whole life. I served my country overseas for years, like multiple tours of duty, like all the sacrifice he's made, all the difficult things he's endured, and then going to that school to try to, you know, heal his own stuff and to be able to heal other people, specifically to heal vets. And so for him to be told on the first day of class that he was this privileged oppressor, you know, in this white supremacist society, he didn't agree with that, you know, so he left. He left after that semester.
Yeah. That's another tragedy. I'm interested in MDMA psychotherapy and performing MDMA psychotherapy, and especially with vets and police officers. The loathing that that the military, that members of the armed services and law enforcement, it's just mind-bending to contemplate the amount of open loathing expressed regarding the military and police amongst the cohort, primarily, at Naropa University.
That's too bad, because those are some of the people that need the most help and the most support, and it just doesn't make sense to try to, like, we're going to get rid of the police? Like, that's not going to work out very well. We need reform, but we actually need some police. We actually need some military. If you want to look at us, this is a whole other topic, but if we got rid of the military, I mean, it just doesn't make sense, right? We need to be practical, and we need to...
I look at it karmically as well. There are protectors and protectees, right? If you like dichotomies, there are protectors and protectees. Ideally, the intended purpose of the military and police is to protect people, to protect innocent people, to protect you and me, to protect you and me from foreign threats, and to protect you and me from criminals. Now, from a Buddhist point of view, When a protector commits an act of violence to protect me, they're taking on this heavy karma. And you can substitute PTSD, right, for ready psychological substitute for karma. They're taking on this, they're incurring this tremendous cost in order to protect innocent people, right? That's what they're there for. Yeah. Now, it doesn't always work out that way, but that's the basic deal. That's the intention.
Yeah.
And then for them to be abandoned by members of the helping profession who just sort of loathe them. And believe that the therapeutic intervention that a police officer most needs is to be converted into woke politics.
Yeah, I feel you. I agree 100%. Well, so in terms of your journey there, at what point did you file the Title IX complaint?
I filed it really early. I filed it...
Oh, okay.
I believe it was something like the day after I got back from quitting the retreat.
Oh, right after quitting the retreat.
Pretty early, maybe the first month.
So that retreat happened at the beginning of the semester.
Yeah. I don't have the timeline on hand, but early first quarter, or first third of the semester.
And how did it feel? At what point did you get the report back? Was that December?
I think it was February, like 2 months after I left the school.
And that must have felt like incredible vindication to read that report.
It was one of the most wonderful feelings I've ever felt.
Wow.
Total vindication. I shared it with all my friends. I shared it with my mom, who was so proud of me. And then actually the report was retracted, which we'll get to. Shortly before my mom died this spring, and I couldn't bring myself to tell her. So she died thinking that the Title IX report had vindicated me. And
I'm sorry, your mom passed. When you say retracted, who retracted it? What does that mean?
Yeah, so I don't know if I filled you in fully on this. So the report was filed. The Title IX coordinator who investigated my case, found Naropa University to be so, what's the word? They were so clueless, and they were so committed to discrimination. Her job is to prevent discrimination, but she was working for an institution that was really openly committed to discrimination in a sense, while also publishing policies saying they oppose discrimination. But they truly are committed to like a woke form, woke branded discrimination. So the Title IX coordinator quit because she couldn't work for a discriminatory institution.
Wow, that's amazing. And she was an independent investigator, right?
Yeah.
But she was paid by Naropa University?
Yeah.
Okay.
She quit before she completed my report. Sorry, I keep bumping this. However, they contracted her to finish the report. Even though she was no longer employed or whatever, it was like a contract. So she completed the report. I believe she submitted it in February or so.
Uh-huh.
I kept waiting and waiting, and I never received the report. And finally, I got a really legalese, very official statement from some legal representative of the university saying that they were rejecting the report because the report failed to meet the parameters. It was not a good report.
Just because the Naropa University administration rejects the report doesn't mean it's not valid and accurate. And again, vindication. So I just am imagining that that month, end of the semester, December, January, before you get the report, it must have been a tough time in your life because you've been ostracized, you've been in this hostile environment, you've made the tough decision to leave and to possibly lose the money and the credits and all that. And
I had spent so much money. I moved to Boulder, then I moved back to Portland 5 months later, tremendous expense. I didn't have a job because I quit my job to move to Boulder. I became clinically depressed. I got COVID right at that time as well.
Oh, man. Yeah.
No, it was a dark time. Also, it was Portland winter. So I'm sure one or two people are chuckling about that. December in Portland is, just picture 40 degrees and heavy rain for about 4 months straight, really. Finally, I got the vindication. And do you want to talk about some of your greatest hits in the report.
Yeah, let's read some of it. So I think I'm gonna I'll create an intro and introduce you and tell some of your story in the beginning to set the stage for the listeners, and I'll read some of the report there probably. But let's look at it. It's a Title IX investigative report that was the complaint that you filed, and maybe I can jump to the part where this investigative lawyer who reported it gives her findings, and she says, using a preponderance of the evidence standard based on the evidence collected, it is more likely than not that Naropa University both discriminated and retaliated against you, and that the university climate and culture generally violates Title IX and university policy prohibiting protected class discrimination as a pattern and practice, thereby resulting in a hostile learning environment against men, and especially those with additional intersecting quote-unquote privileged characteristics, which she identifies as being white, heterosexual, and Christian, which is an interesting one.
That might be, I'm just speculating that that might be informed by other complaints that she received in that office.
Yeah. And let's see, it says, while Naropa's mission and values focused on issues of equity and diversity are laudable, the manner in which they have been advanced in this case clearly run afoul of Naropa's published policy and federal non-discrimination laws, including Title IX. Title IX requires that no person shall be on the basis of sex, be excluded from participation in, be denied the benefit of, or be subjected to discrimination under any education program receiving federal financial assistance. And then she writes that you voiced opinions which do not conform to ideologies advanced and embraced by Naropa University, which do in fact perpetuate biased attitudes about men. Whether this bias is justified to advance social and racial equity is open to debate. Naropa University has taken the position that it is not only justifiable, but represents a moral and ethical imperative. The culture at Naropa University, specifically within the CPBP program, reflects this. And so, yeah, it's just amazing. It's an amazing report.
You know, one of the most thrilling parts of it was the restitution section.
Oh, yeah. She wrote that... let's see. She writes, restitution should be made to you to include minimally a refund of all monies paid by you to Naropa University, tuition fees, etc., out-of-pocket expenses, travel expenses, and compensation for lost time. Now, obviously, that hasn't happened, but it's nice that she thought that it should.
Right. I mean, it was within grasp. It was within my grasp. And so now where we're at is there's a new Title IX coordinator who is telling me that from the university's perspective, it's as if that report and that investigation never happened. So I have to file
an application. How can they say that when it did happen?
Right. Well, you know, it's like when the judge says to strike that testimony from the record and instructs the jury, like, that's inadmissible, right? Something like that.
But isn't the whole point of an independent investigation is that it's independent of the thing it's investigating? So it's not up to Naropa University to determine whether it's valid or not. It's up to the independent investigator to make that.
Right. I would think that they would, I would think that the university leadership would be interested in this finding and not say, oh, you didn't dot your I's and cross your T's. I think they would be interested in the evidence that they've created systematically and pervasively created a discriminatory environment.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
Harming people. Not, well, yes, we are doing that, but you didn't cross your eyes. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I would.
Well, the other thing is like for every, I'm guessing it's actually quite unusual for you to file the Title IX complaint, and it's to your credit. I'm glad that you did, but I'm guessing there's a lot more men, like all the people I've spoken to who have complaints, not just men, people at Naropa who have complaints along these lines, and the school's not listening to them. It's been going on for years now. Like, I was hearing about this back in 2016. Here we are, 2022. And so they're not listening. They're not changing their ways. If anything, they're doubling down, I guess.
Yeah.
And that's a shame because, like we've said, it's actually causing harm. It's not helping. It's not healing. It's not, right. I don't think it's doing us any good, generally speaking. Can I read one more part of the report?
Sure.
This again is in the kind of conclusion. It says right here, in 2016, the university hired an outside investigator to examine allegations of disparate and discriminatory treatment of men in the psychology program. And then it goes on to say, specifically, the report found that notions of, quote, white male privilege and, quote, male privilege are frequently taught and discussed, and that this is frequently done in an accusatory manner, making men feel attacked. In my tenure as the Title IX coordinator at Naropa University, 100% of the formal complaints received by the Title IX office are focused on allegations of pervasive discrimination against those from perceived, quote, dominant oppressor groups, end quote, parentheses, always male, within the CPBP program. Men's opinions, particularly when they deviate from Naropa's prevailing ideology, are routinely dismissed in class discussions, i.e. they are taking up space, don't understand how their social location impacts students from marginalized groups and how it may be harmful to such students. In effect, men are routinely excluded, derided, ostracized, and dismissed, and or are accused of being racist, unaware, or harmful. In some cases, these men face punitive action or are excluded from successfully progressing through the program for nonconformance with the culture, which penalizes men for engaging in alternatives. Wow. I mean, that's incredible, right? That is just amazing.
Yeah, that paragraph is a tour de force. I don't know why the university is not interested in fixing that. And the Title IX report goes on to suggest, to recommend changes in leadership, changes in curriculum, retraining faculty maybe might be in there, but definitely removing some faculty, I think, is implied.
Hmm. Yeah, it seems like this. It's an issue of the culture that's been encouraged there and developed there. And when I think about Naropa University, what I wish in my ideal world is that they would really take pride in their Buddhist heritage, right? And like root down in that and offer that to students like yourself who are inspired and interested in Dharma and meditation practice. And it's meant to be a school to bring that out into the greater world. And it's just a shame that it seems like that's been totally put to the side in favor of this ideology, this far woke, far left ideology that, like we said, is Marxist. And it's like anti-spirituality, anti-religion in some ways. And it's just so ironic and disturbing.
Right. It's a supreme tragedy that it's both anti-Buddhist, which is a funny phrase, but it's also anti-therapeutic. You know, as is well documented in Coddling of the American Mind, the axioms of woke are kind of the opposite of what have been empirically demonstrated to be effective psychological treatments for depression, anxiety, whatever, through cognitive behavioral therapy. So yeah, here you have a mental health counseling program that has elevated political ideology. It doesn't even make sense. Above its twin mandates of Buddhism. Or mandate is a weird word too, but you know, it's anti the politics are raised above Buddhism and above even psychotherapy.
It's tragic.
It's such a tremendous missed opportunity.
I guess one thing I want to,
in the context of a Marxist takeover where the founder of the university fled a Marxist takeover.
I mean, it's almost unbelievable. I mean, I hope that this podcast helps shed light on it and maybe hopefully leads to some changes. I mean, one thing I want to add here is that Naropa University does have some great teachers. It does have some great classes. It does produce some really wonderful therapists and people in the world, you know, writers and activists and people doing good things. And so I think what I observed and what I think happens, like you said, some of the wisest people or men in your program that you noticed were just staying silent. I think part of what happens is, people just kind of hold their tongue, they hold back, they don't engage or challenge this ideology in the way that you did. And then they complete the program. And like, while it does tend to get brought into the majority of the classes, it can be kind of like, oh, there's that woke stuff. You just kind of ignore it. And then you focus on the learning the therapy, the psychology, the meditation, all that stuff, all the good stuff. And that could be, you know, that's a way to navigate the program and get a lot out of it and get benefit from it. But it's not fundamentally as honest and as brave as what you did, which was to say, hey, I'm not going to do this thing because I don't want to do it.
I hope it's of benefit.
Yeah.
And yeah, speaking of courage, I want to thank you and highlight your own courage. When I originally reached out to you in Boulder, you met me at a coffee shop, and it was really powerful to find an ally out out there, you know, in the greater world outside the cohort, because the cohort sure got stuffy. So I thank you for making yourself available and it culminating in this.
Yeah.
You know, you're really extending yourself and putting yourself at, I mean, let's face it, the threat of cancellation is a real one, and it has real, cancellation has real impact. So I applaud you as well for your courage.
Thanks. Yeah, it does take courage, and it, you know, I really appreciate how you began this conversation, that you're totally against racism and discrimination and all these things. And so to be able to kind of walk, try to, part of what I'm trying to do is walk this fine line and this balance of like, I want to speak out against what I see as extremism on the far left that's gone too far, that's actually causing harm, that's actually shutting people down, that's telling people things about themselves just based on their external characteristics, right? Like we've talked about. And like, racism is wrong. And we, you know, we should try to be creating a better, more equitable, more beautiful world that we all know is possible, right? Like it's a both and for me. That like part of the work of trying to help people, of being compassionate, of bringing wisdom and compassion in myself and out in the world as much as I can is opposing extremism on all sides. And that's, you know, brings me back to the Buddha's famous middle way, right?
Right.
Let's find the middle way here. Let's not identify ourselves based on these superficial characteristics. Let's not identify ourselves with these ideologies. Any ideology taken to an extreme is going to cause harm. That's what the middle way philosophy and teachings are all about. We don't hold on to a viewpoint, even a viewpoint of like emptiness. If you can hold on to that too much and go too extreme and become nihilistic, you know, or something. So we want to find this middle way that truth is beyond concepts, beyond identities. It's definitely beyond emotionality. Yeah.
Yeah. Well put. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.
How's your meditation practice persevering through all this?
That's another loss. I mean, I can't entirely play the victim. But my Naropa University experience kind of ruined meditation for me.
I hate to hear that.
I have to share responsibility, but you know, they broke my heart, and to be so thoroughly attacked and rejected and disappointed by a Buddhist institution. I'm trying to reestablish a practice. I stopped meditating in the program because it was like connected with them.
That's painful to hear.
Yeah.
I hope you can get back to it, and that can be a source of support and strength. And it can also be good from sometimes to take a break, you know, and then you'll have a fresh start, which is another phrase I learned at Naropa University.
All right. Yeah, I'm right on the cusp of reestablishing a daily practice. So I think it'll be soon and helpful.
Well, thank you so much for your time and for sharing this, and wish you all the best with your journey moving forward, and you're hopefully can become a healer and do the work that you really want to do in the world.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for listening to another episode of A State of Mind podcast. I work here in Boulder, Colorado as a therapist, coach, and meditation teacher. You can learn more about that at my website, astateofmindcounseling.org. And you can learn more about the podcast at astateofmindpodcast.com. Any donation is greatly appreciated. You can support the show directly at patreon.com/astateofmind. Thank you so much, and I look forward to seeing you here next time.